Here we go. 3, 2, 1.
Hello again, guys, and we are back. I mean, we actually survived our first show. It seemed to go quite well. People seemed to have liked it, so we thought we'd give another go of a new show. And here we go. So it's Andy Mercer again on the mic at the moment with my co-host, Ron Murphy. Ron, how are you doing?
I am doing fine, my friend. I trust everything is going for you as well.
Yeah, not too bad at all. We just... We're getting over the Christmas horrors and settling things down, waiting for the new year to start. Because this is that funny week, isn't it, kind of between Christmas and New Year. We're not really kind of back into the normal swing of things, but not really kind of holidaying anymore. The whole holiday season itself is kind of finished, the Christmas bit. And you have these few days in the middle that kind of just sort of, you sort of sit around, don't you? I mean, I don't work during this particular time. My wife, who works in London, a big city nearby, doesn't work this week. So we're both kind of twiddling our thumbs a bit, really. So it's quite good to be doing the show, actually.
It is. The children are already bored because they're about 4 or 5 days into the Christmas vacation. But what's going to be interesting about this show is that it will actually air after the new year. But as we're doing this right now, this is the waning days of 2016. So we can complain about 2016 all that we want to, because by the time the show airs, like I said, it will be a brand new year, 2017.
It will be indeed, and we'll have escaped all the horrors of Christmas and New Year, and we'll be starting off afresh and new, looking forward to what can please be a better year than 2016. That's hopefully, we've only got a couple of days left, so hopefully no more celebrities are going to leave us. It's been one of those dreadful years of everyone seems to run off the planet. And
That's right. Yeah, that's what I was going to, one of my main items that I wanted to talk about was the amount of celebrity deaths. Now, I'm sure that this has happened before in the history of the world, but I do not remember so many high-profile celebrities dying within 1 year. Princess Leia leaving us. I mean, what kind of fun can we hope for in 2017 without our princess being around?
Absolutely, yes. I mean, it's obviously a more practical note. I wonder how they'd worked into the scripting of the new films they're doing at the moment. I mean, obviously, we've had Rogue One out recently, but that was set earlier on. So we've got the Star Wars Episode 8, I think it is, coming up. And whether they'd filmed that already or they've worked at what they're going to do there. But just as a person, it's just a sad loss. And, of course, a mum dying the following day. And you have to speculate that perhaps it was the shock of losing her daughter that actually led her to pass away herself. It really was quite so quickly, one after the other.
It was. Now, from what I've gathered, the next Star Wars movie, Carrie Fisher did indeed film her entire role for that. So, but it was going to arc over into the final movie of the trilogy as well. So there's going to have to be something done in regard to that. I mean, and it's a shame that we're talking about entertainment in a time like this, but there's so many people that have Star Wars as a very real part of their lives. Mm-hmm. You know, the idea of the Force as a practiced religion is actually accepted some places. So, you know, it's a sad occurrence that a human being died, but then in the alternate reality where this person is a character, there's so many people clinging to that person as well, too. And then that person will be dead within a year because they're not going to be able to film anymore with her.
Absolutely. I mean, it is one of those things that Star Wars itself has become such an ingrained into people's growing up experiences from the 70s onwards. I can remember we had the census over here in the UK. We have them every 10 years, and it's usually on the 01 of the year or 11. And I think it was 2001, the census actually recorded, obviously, people's religions, and they put down Jediism, or being a Jedi. And there were enough people that wrote that down that had to recognize as a religion in the UK.
So. That's the reason I made that comment, because, yeah, people were seeing it as a true spiritual spiritual path to follow. And I guess, I mean, the things that you and I talk about, you know, Lucas was very much into the works of Joseph Campbell and mm-hmm. Carl Jung. So you do see a lot of these kind of elements within Star Wars. So to think that people would assume it as a religion, you know, it is, you know, it is the next logical step for some people. I do think that way. The reason that Star Wars is so universal and why it means so much to people is because it is dealing with archetypes and images and you know, antagonists and protagonists that are recognizable on throughout the human spectrum.
Absolutely. It is one of those things that made it so successful was it very much followed the classic fairy tale line of the trapped princess and the young hero coming to rescue from the evil villain. It really did sort of work along those lines. And certainly, I mean, I'm quite interested in Taoism, which talks about sort of the way as well, which you can see the Force and Taoism have certain definite parallels. I mean, there is elements of Taoist alchemy that claims you can make changes in the reality around you through their use of alchemy, but it doesn't quite work the same way it does in Star Wars as moving objects around. But that kind of theme is definitely visible there. But I think it also highlights the interesting fact that clearly people do still have a place for some kind of religious ideas in their lives, some kind of sort of spiritual idea, should we say, rather than religious. That because we live in a very materialistic modern society, that spiritual value seems to have disappeared in so many aspects of our lives. So that people do kind of look for things that may be alternatives to what already exists. And you know, maybe Star Wars might be an odd place to look, but if it gives you some kind of spiritual meaning, then well, who's to say that's a bad thing?
Absolutely. I agree with you completely, my friend. And I think that this is the reason why this show has a bit of growing popularity. You had mentioned that, you know, this is our second show. The first one is out of the way. And I was very happy by seeing a lot of people, you know, liking what we were doing.
Mm. Absolutely. So far it seems to have gone down pretty well. I've had to listen back a few times. A couple of things I'd like to change next time. Make sure the music at the start's not quite so loud. It did rather drown me out at first. That's a little learning experience there. But generally speaking, I think, I didn't come across any particularly negative comments. I hope you people are happy to listen to us do rambling on for a couple of hours about various things. But certainly,
That's right.
It is very much a case of trying to kind of keep things moving along nicely so we don't just sort of seem as if we are sort of stagnant. We're just kind of moving ourselves forward with our conversations particularly, yeah.
Yeah, stagnation is never a good thing. But the one overriding opinion I think that's given to us is that our intelligence is only eclipsed by our brutal sense of masculinity. Are you finding that as well, too, that a lot of the ladies are commenting that it is our sex appeal that is really keeping the show going?
It's good you it's on radio then rather than TV. You like a sex Perfect voice for radio.
Well, when we get our own television show, we'll see what happens.
Absolutely, yes. It might be time for a bit of cosmetic surgery or just a mask, one of the two. But, it was quite funny. So I sent you last time and talking to a friend of mine on Facebook. It was an old friend of mine, but I know her from Facebook as well. And I said, are you too sure you're not related to each other? You do look alike. But it's just one of those things.
I've heard that as well, too. And, you know, maybe we'll do a DNA test. You know, sometime in 2017, we'll have a show just devoted to us having a DNA test. We'll do through like some sort of Ancestry.com sponsorship or whatever.
Absolutely.
And we'll just read our DNA. So let me ask you, Mr. Mercer, what is occupying your free time? What are you watching? I know that you sent me a complete miniseries, which I've been looking at right now. Is that what's occupying your time? Are you watching The Man in the High Castle?
Absolutely. I found the whole show absolutely fascinating. It's been one of those things that I like the occasional sort of TV series. I like to watch them all at once, and it is coming via Amazon Prime, which is quite useful because they let you have the whole lot at once rather than dragging it week after week. But it is a particularly fascinating concept and idea. Just briefly for our listeners who've not come across the TV series, now I have heard that it is absolutely flying in America. It's been popular here as well, but obviously it's set in the States, so it has got a big audience over there. It's based on the novel by Philip K. Dick, who wrote, among other novels, stories that became the films Total Recall and Blade Runner. So it might not recognize the name initially, but he used the brains behind those sort of stories, the really popular sci-fi adventures. This one is a bit different. It's basically an alternative history. It's set in the early 1960s in a world in which the Nazis and Japan won the Second World War. So you're dealing with a rather grim world there, to say the least. And America itself doesn't exist as an entity anymore. It's been split in roughly half or into three quarters, or three thirds, as I say, sort of more than a third of it is ruled by the Nazis on the East Coast. There's a large demilitarized zone or buffer in the middle, and then the West Coast is ruled by Japan. That of itself is an interesting concept. There's a whole idea of the what ifs, you know, what could happen if, you know, the history gone a different way, the alternative versions. I mean, there was a film and a book not so long ago called Fatherland, which was along a similar lines of the Nazis conquered Europe but didn't conquer America. They simply took over the Europe by threatening to blow up a nuclear bomb over London, and the Americans signed a peace treaty. So America's still independent and free, but Germany rules the whole of Europe. And in that film and novel, what happens is they're trying to find some kind of peace deal with America and start trading with America, and then the truth about the Holocaust comes out, which of course would have been much bigger in Europe had the Nazis won, and America discovered the reality of what they'd hushed up, and that kind of ends any kind of agreement between them. And I think eventually they end up going to war in the idea of Fatherland. But this takes things a stage further, where you have got the Nazis pretty much controlling with a puppet regime in the novel and in direct control in the TV series. So there's some differences there. But there's something else going on, which, you know, if you know the story at all or have any idea about the TV series, you already have an idea. So I'm going to say something that if you haven't seen it and don't want it spoilt, do apologize, but there is more happening. There's more meets the eye. It's not just the alternative early 1960s history. There's something else happening that starts to play a bigger and bigger role. Certainly in the second season, it becomes a more prominent feature. As I said at the beginning, it is a science fiction series, so there's obviously something else happening there. And we're talking about the ideas of other realities, the idea of parallel existences, which is a feature of a number of different stories and ideas that have bounced around over the years. But to me, this is one of the best representations of the ideas of the existence of parallel realities. Now, I know you've had the first season, Ron. Now, I can give you the links to watch the second season fairly soon, but what do you make of it?
You know what, I, as somebody that is a student of history, I think that these kind of programs are essential whenever we look at the worldview as a whole, especially with the Trump candidacy, because a lot of people are talking about the way America will be, you know, reshaped under his regime or presidency, whatever you would want to call it, depending upon which side you're on, you know. But they're talking about the rise of white supremacy, and they're talking about, you know, our allegiance with Russia and some of our other ties to other countries on which we have been allies for years, maybe straining a bit. So I think that these programs are essential in the way we look at history as a whole. And whenever I was in graduate school studying history, I remember one military history class that we had to take and talk about the consequences if the South had won our Civil War, you know. Mm-hmm. And the professor said, you know, slavery may have existed in the South until the 1920s before it would have eventually gradually faded away. But these kind of things are very tantalizing, aren't they? I mean, this is also going to come into the reason, you know, or the subject that we're going to be talking about eventually today, the idea of Jack the Ripper. Mm-hmm. I mean, these kind of alternate realities all come into play too, because he's still a mystery. So, you know, we're basically speculating on who the Ripper may be, and this goes down these other tangents and about other related histories and everything. So I think that this all kind of plays together in the grand scheme of things.
Absolutely. I mean, just pick up on the Ripper point for a moment there. I mean, a couple of the theories we're definitely going to talk about. You are talking about almost alternate realities, as in the kind of a hidden underworld that would have to be going on and exist for these theories to be true, that whilst in themselves they are debatable whether these theories particularly are real, but the whole idea, there's certain, as we know, Masonic theories, there's royal family involvement theories that would both point to a very different kind of reality that's actually existing under the surface, you like, of our reality. And again, the idea of you can move between these different realities by taking aboard different concepts, different ideas. I mean, you can imagine one of the strongest themes that you do find is the alternate idea of the Nazis winning World War II. But I mean, I remember watching a series years back on, again, that premise of what if the South had won the Civil War, and it was like a TV program that was like charting the history of America post the Civil War. And some of the products and some of the things that advertised on it could be seen as being quite racist and quite divisory, but they were shown within the context of this Confederate States of America being a racist state. But then at the end, they showed the adverts you were watching that during the program were real adverts that really had existed. And then you do look back now and you think, God, that's awful. It was just an ordinary TV advert. I can't remember the name of the series, the program, but it was very, very good.
Yeah, if you happen to remember that, maybe we'll share it on a future show. Mm. But even looking at the way Walt Disney, you know, the iconic Walt Disney portrayed, you know, African Americans, you know, at the turn of the century and even into the early 1900s. I mean, we would look at that today as completely despicable. But that was something that was, you know, partial to what they were putting out as entertainment.
Mm, absolutely, and it's, as I say, it's the sort of things you look at today with modern eyes, you think, bloody hell, that's a bit ridiculous. But unfortunately, they didn't have the benefit of sort of a wider understanding, and stereotyping was quite a common feature. I mean, again, one of the interesting things about the High Castle program that plays out is obviously, you know, if Nazi eugenics programs had been carried out across most of the world, what would the world look like? And it was quite a scary prospect, to say the least. You know, it was clearly they'd wiped out, obviously Jews had been completely wiped out, but also most of Europeans have been wiped out. There were hints that Africa had been pretty much taken over completely, and in kind of hinted towards a parallel to what had happened to the Native Americans in America during the sort of the times of the Wild West, how they'd been almost pretty much wiped out. The suggestion was that that similar kind of wiping out had happened in Africa, and they were trying to basically turn it white and make North Africa, especially, was trying to fertilize it so it'd become a place they could grow food and crops in what was now a desert. And there was, it's in the novel, but it is hints in the program again to the idea of actually draining the whole of the Mediterranean and using the water there to then feed into North Africa to make it fertile. It was like, my God, that's quite terrifying. But there were other strange hints of what was going on. I mean, someone else pointed out, and I was reading, and it was quite true. This is set in 1962, but yet they had electric monorails in Berlin. It was like technology that was way beyond what they could have developed in the 1960s. Their incredibly fast jet aircraft were flying faster than Concorde, which was probably one of the fastest commercial aircraft that was around, and that was in the 80s. So this is the early 60s, and they were crossing the Atlantic in 4 hours. So there was more going on even there that was you'd have to kind of pick up upon. That it was this kind of game of reality being played, and so that underlying theme of, you know, is the world that we live in the real world? Is there something more going on? Is there something hidden? I mean, the obvious parallel that comes up is The Matrix, where we look at the idea that we're all plugged into some giant supercomputer, and the reality that we think we're living in is just computer-generated. And, of course...
Have you got the chance to watch the HBO show Westworld yet?
Absolutely. I was going to come on to that, funny enough, yes.
It's that same idea, isn't it? I mean, they were talking about programming, essentially, you know, computers that are in the form of a human being. And their idea, their rationale is once this computer develops some sort of feelings or thoughts beyond its programming, there is an element of humanity to it. Now, I'm not sure if I buy that or not, because in the end, you're still working with nuts and bolts and, you know, A plus B, you know, you're still dealing with a program there. But it is still one of those interesting and rather intriguing ideas that we can produce, you know, a separate humanity beyond what we originally intended.
Mm-hmm, absolutely, and that's one of the underlying themes again. There is the concept of consciousness. You know, that's one of the things that's good about some of the new TV that's coming out is it's deeper. You know, there is more going on. You can watch the Westworld as being this kind of battle between the robots versus the humans. The robots seem to be more and more organic, and they kind of been built using 3D printers. I mean, we do get into the deeper question of, you know, what is consciousness? What is sentientness? Because, again, without giving anything away, you're led to think that some of these robots are becoming sentient, but then there are clues and hints that that's not actually happening. Something else is going on under the surface. But that whole concept of the alternate realities, the idea of you know, what is real. I mean, obviously, if you walk into the worst world, if you could, you would have difficulty knowing straight away who was human and who was robot, who was mechanical, because they are so well designed and so well created. And it is a fascinating concept. You know, will we get to the point where our computers are that sort of powerful enough to actually become sentient? And I think at the moment the answer has to be no, because they don't work the same way the human brain does. It's a, you know, perhaps a longer conversation for another time, but the whole point of a computer is they work in serial. It's one thing after another, incredibly, incredibly quickly, but they don't run full parallel programming. A human mind is parallel. It works in many different things simultaneously, not one after the other, which a computer essentially does. It doesn't work as a human brain does, doing lots and lots of things absolutely at the same time. So that's one of the most fundamentals, that you'd have to really start building computers from the first steps up. The current ones, the way they work now, it would never become fully sentient. It can give the impression of sentient, which they've called the Turing test, where you see if you can deceive someone into thinking they're talking to a person when it's actually a machine. You can create those, certainly, but not truly sentient. And I think that's one of the things that Westworld is playing with, that whole notion is, are these beings becoming sentient, or are they being programmed to appear to be sentient? And that, again, is a fascinating topic, which, as I say, you could watch the whole show and not pick up on that at all, and still love it, still enjoy it, but then you start thinking a bit deeper, think, hey, there is a bit more going on here, and it is very cleverly done. Definitely.
It most certainly is. And it's also sold as a commodity. This is where very rich and wealthy people go to experience a fantasy world. So what the creators of Westworld, their intention was, is not so much to make these robots to be, you know, full of human emotion, but to convince people that are coming there and are paying their money that these robots are actually interacting with them as a human being would, mm-hmm. and even falling in love with them. And so it's kind of like a power trip for a human to go there and think that, you know, these gorgeous, you know, ladies are falling in love with them because of their outward appearance, when in fact they were simply programmed to do that.
Absolutely. And that, of course, again, is the key question, is, you know, what is this actually is happening here? Again, that kind of whole question of, are these robots becoming sentient, or are they made to appear to be sentient? Because you're also left with this question that, you know, that one of the central characters of them, played by Anthony Hopkins, is he trying to develop them into sentient, or is he trying to hold their sentience back? You're really not quite sure, because I think it looks like for a long time it's one direction, and at the end you think, actually, no, he's doing the other thing. He's doing the opposite, and that's what makes it really fascinating. But, I mean, going back to that question of whether we can create sentient robots and machines, there's a fabulous book I read recently by Sir Roger Penrose, who's a scientist and does a lot of philosophy over here in the UK, called The Emperor's New Mind, that really goes into a lot of detail about that concept of human consciousness and robotic consciousness being possible. And it is absolutely fascinating. He says, basically, when I borrowed his idea, he's basically saying, no, it's not possible, because of the way in which the computers actually work at the moment. But that's not to say it wouldn't be impossible at some point in the future to create robots that could become sentient. But at the moment, we can manufacture the appearance of sentience very, very convincingly, but it doesn't mean they are necessarily sentient. So again, it's that sentient.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the reasons why Star Wars, getting back to Star Wars, is so appealing, right? Is that you have these little companion robots, these little friends that seem to be, you know, emotionally attached to their owners. Even in Rogue One, we have this idea that, you know, that these robots have a life outside of the way that they were programmed. And that's what makes these movies so appealing, I think, is because, you know, it's the idea of another type of intelligence having those same type of feelings as a human being.
Absolutely. And I love the way, actually, in Star Wars, the whole question is totally sidestepped. There's no explanation if these have achieved sentientness themselves, or they're built to be sentient, or are sentient. They're just there, aren't they? Almost like mechanical humans. It's quite amazing. I mean, if you think, going to the other major science fiction series, Star Trek, the whole question was explored with Data, of course, in The Next Generation, whether he was sentient, or, you know, did he have his own consciousness, or was he just acting as a program? So that is kind of discussed there in some depth, and it's explored several times. But with Star Wars, now these robots, they're intelligent, they think for themselves.
That's right. And apparently a child can program them to do this thing. So according to the canon of the Star Wars universe, you know, the young Anakin Skywalker in the very first episode, which was, what was it, the
Phantom Menace.
Boy, I think, The Phantom Menace, that's right. Apparently a child can program these robots to do these kind of things.
Absolutely. I mean, he builds 3PO, doesn't he, as well? Which it can kind of ties into this thing I read a long while ago. The main characters of Star Wars are the droids. They've got the two things that kind of exist throughout the entire series of all the films, the only things that really do.
Whenever Star Wars came out in 77, the first image that I received of Star Wars in my 7-year-old brain was seeing an image of C-3PO. And I think it might have even been on a science magazine like Discover or something like that. So it was part of the mainstream science literature because these were something that were never really seen before. Mm. We had some ideas of what robots were capable of if we look back at Lost in Space, you know, and mm-hmm. even before that with The Forbidden Planet. We see these programmed servants, basically. But this is the first time you see them as acting as like, you know, a typical British butler would be in one of the sitcoms or something. Yeah. They're there for you know, a comedic overtones and undertones. But this is the first time we saw them acting as these kind of particular characters, these kind of foils or this kind of comic relief.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. It's interesting also to notice that obviously the biggest British sci-fi series of all time has been Doctor Who, and two of the main most sort of recognisable villains, both the Daleks and the Cybermen, are both human or animal or organism-based. You know, when you first see things like the Daleks, you wouldn't have realised actually there's an organism, and quite quickly you discover there's an organism inside it that is driving the Dalek body. And the Cybermen, and actually, are basically human beings inside that cyber suit. Minds have been taken over completely. So they didn't even go into the whole realm of purely robotic or purely android machines in Doctor Who. Most of the early creatures were still human-based, or at least animal-based. So it's interesting that they didn't... It was almost, as you say, kind of comically seen as not being kind of believable, the robots as being kind of on the side, not being that main villains or being particularly kind of powerful. And now it's kind of gone completely opposite direction. We've got these things that clearly are machine-based. I mean, I think of like the Cylons, rather, from Battlestar Galactica, both the original and the new one. Again, there's that kind of, you know, robotic intelligence, these kind of manufactured minds. Although, again, even the Cylons, the guys at the top, are still living creatures as well, if I remember right. We haven't seen it for a long time, I must admit. But it's interesting the way they kind of play with that whole notion of robotic, purely robotic versus organistic bodies, shall we say. My tongue's
well, before we get... Before we get off this subject, I do want to bring up one idea of pseudo-history and one idea of robotics interacting with the human world. And I want to bring up Steven Spielberg's Artificial Intelligence, the AI movie, that was one of those movies that seemed to suggest that surrogate children could be created to take the place of a living child. It was done in a way that you did have an emotional attachment to that young boy. You wanted to make sure that everything was okay with him. But I remember watching this movie being reviewed by Siskel and Ebert. And Gene Siskel said that you really should have had it was Roger Ebert that said it. He said you should have really had no emotional investment in the movie because it would be as if your calculator was broken. You would simply throw it away. Mm. And I think that there is an understanding to be had of that as well, too, because I don't know if we can ever be that emotionally tied to a computer or something mechanical that you would have those kind of feelings for, you know, a living person. What is your opinion on that?
It is an interesting question. It is essentially about deception, because it is you've been deceived into believing what you're dealing with, as in the film, is a real child or is a mechanical representation of it. But I mean, you could say people fall in love with their pets, but pets, again, they're organic creatures. They're separate entities in their own existence. With a robot, you are, no matter how convincing it might be, you are still dealing with a thing that has been made by somebody else. It's not organically grown by itself. I mean, you may have made it yourself, you may have built it, but it's still something that you have constructed in a very precise way, that you've given it all the attributes it's got, whereas, of course, a child, a human being born, grows of itself once it's born. And although you influence it in terms of what you teach a child, both as a parent and as a teacher, you are still influencing something that's happening organically. It's progressing by itself, and the machine obviously would never do that. But again, there's a good example in Westworld. I mean, without giving too much away, we discover at one point that one of the characters that we were led to believe all along was human isn't. And suddenly your whole sense of who that character is suddenly dramatically changes. You know, blimey, yeah, I didn't realize that. So again,
that's right. Yeah, and the idea of trying to figure out human from machine, there's that very interesting opening scene in Blade Runner whenever they're sitting down with the replicant and trying to ask the correct questions to prove that it's a replicant rather than a human. See, these are interesting ideas as well, too, that's to be made, that can we as human beings figure out who is trying to deceive us and when they're trying to deceive us.
Absolutely. Of course, you bring up a very good point with Blade Runner, because we're left at the end not really knowing if Deckard is human, and the main character, Harrison Ford's character, is human, or he is a replicant himself. Because, of course, you've got that little scene at the end where the other guy makes the unicorn, don't you, out of tin foil, and leaves it, and knowing that Ford's been, or Deckard's been dreaming of unicorns. It's like, how do you know what I've been dreaming about? Are you human, or am I a replicant? And I know that the director, whose name must have just escaped me, kind of hinted towards, actually, he might be replicant, but we now know, of course, Blade Runner 2 is being made, so that question might get answered. But of course, it brings us back full circuit, because Blade Runner is based on Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep by Philip K. Dick, who wrote Man in a High Castle. So we kind of got nicely in circle there, really, haven't we?
See how nice that works? That's
absolutely
right. Yeah, and these are all very poignant topics, because I think 2017 is going to be a pivotal time in human history. Maybe not so melodramatic as that, but it's going to be a time in human history that we've never seen before, because our country, America, is going to be run by non-politicos. You know, these are people that really have no idea. So we're going to see the world through a different lens than we have never seen before. And then your country, as you said, I just checked the other day that your pound is dropping tremendously. The last time I was in England, I think that it was about $1.70 or something for 1 pound. You know, it was very, very – now it's like $1.25 or something. I mean, it's drastically dropping. So there's a flux going in there. There's a change in the air.
Absolutely. I mean, it is a bit of a bugbear for me, because I buy quite a lot of books from America, so it's stuffed me completely, basically, because of the weakness of the pound. But it is, because we're going to uncharted territory. I mean, those who support the European, us leaving the European Union, say, well, it's a temporary thing and things will right themselves. Maybe, maybe not. But the reality is the markets don't like uncertainty. I used to work in the financial markets many years ago, and the one thing they don't like is uncertainty. If they know it's going to happen and when it's going to happen, then they can cope with it. But if they don't know what's going to happen next, then usually the effect is the currencies tend to get weakened by that. Unfortunately, that's exactly what we're experiencing. But again, you raised a good point. I do think it's a pivotal time. I think next year will be very interesting, because you have somebody who's nominally the leader of the Republican Party, but most of the Republican Party don't want to know. They're not interested. They see him as an outsider. And look at most of the appointments of high office he's made so far. They're all outsiders. They are looking like he intends to run America like a business, which hopefully will be the business he's run that have been successful, not the ones that haven't been, because that would be a problem for everybody.
Yeah, it's hard to put a closed sign on a country.
Exactly, that's the worry. If he runs it like the hotel business, Trump Towers, you'll be fine. If he runs it like Trump University, you're in trouble, and so are we.
That's right. Well, I think that, you know, the idea that, you know, American educational system, it's very expensive to be educated here, and I think that we're going to see that. I think we're going to see that chasm between those that are educated and those that simply cannot afford education. Mm. That's going to happen. And a lot of the powers that be think that this is, you know, it's a privilege and not necessarily a right. Now, I personally don't feel that way, because I think that anytime you have a country, it bodes well to have a citizenry that is very well educated and has a good healthcare system to keep them, fundamentally fit. You know, you would like to have a good workforce and a good think tank there. But apparently other people don't see it that way. It makes perfect sense to me, but apparently the powers that be don't see it that same way. That's a little too liberal for them, I guess.
I agree with you entirely. I mean, we're fortunate here that basic education up to secondary school level, sort of under 16, to 16 years old, is completely free. I mean, I used to be a school teacher, so I know the system from the inside. But post-16, into university is getting more and more expensive. Again, it tends to be loans which have to be repaid under certain circumstances, and there are ways in which you don't pay back, or you don't earn enough. But, you know, the threshold is quite low, so most people who go to university and education now will end up having to pay back quite a lot of money over a number of years. But they don't have to fund it up front, which I think you tend to in America, don't you? You have to sort of produce it there and then. So our system does work reasonably well, but again, some people think it's a bit too easygoing and that people should be forced to pay more, particularly in the healthcare service we have over here, the NHS, that it is what they call free at the point of use, but you know, you can book appointments at doctors and you don't pay anything to go see a doctor, whereas in most countries you pay at least something. And I wouldn't be surprised if we don't start moving towards a kind of a basic fee for that, because when we've been paying prescriptions, for a number of years, and that's steadily going up and up and up. So I can see they might introduce something like that with doctor's appointments, particularly when we know we have a shortage of GPs, and often people book appointments and then don't turn up, which, you know, is ridiculous because people do need these appointments. So perhaps being charged for not turning up to an appointment might be a way forward, I don't know. But, you know, you have to balance these things and just simply say, well, we're going to make everyone pay for everything, and if you can't afford it, tough life. You know, that's not a good place to be, I don't think.
It's not. That's not a kinder, gentler nation, is it? That's what that's what Ronald Reagan talked about, and that's what the first first George Bush talked about, is to have a kinder, gentler nation. That doesn't really happen whenever we don't take into account the people that cannot afford to be a part of that nation, which is ideal that we're talking about pseudo-history, because that's what this is all about. I mean, we don't know where America is going, and we can pontificate about the directions, but until that time, until the actual circumstances happen and show themselves, we have to try to figure out where this might go. And one of the ways to do this is by looking into the past, and that's what is so interesting about The Man in the High Castle, is that we're dealing with true historical events, just transferred to a later time and a later date. Which is another interesting theory behind all this. There was a book out relatively recently, which I forget the name of, but it was about the Viking conquest of North America and what would have happened if they were able to establish more than just a foothold up in Newfoundland, if they were actually able to establish an actual society, a culture within the New World. See, that's interesting to me as well, too, because they would have been here 500 years before Columbus, so they might have even already established a country of their own by that time. So these kind of ideas are very interesting. So when we look at, the possibility, that part of history, what happens if the Vikings would have settled here, or the South would have won, or if Japan and Germany would have won. Now we can take that by extension into 2017 and think, well, what's going to happen in the Trump presidency if he does this particular thing, or what's going to happen in the UK if they do this or they don't do that? So we can figure out a sort of a crystal ball about what's going on by looking at the occasions and the circumstances of the past.
Absolutely, though there's hopefully we can all learn from the past, that we're trying to avoid the mistakes that have been made in the past and not let them happen again. But unfortunately, sometimes short-sightedness means that we'll just do what we think is going to be nice for us and solve the future consequences, basically. It's can happen that way, but say for both our countries, we are in that kind of unexplored territory. You've never had a president who's been as an Amazon outsider, who is nominally the leader of the Republican Party, because I know that's how it works. President is the leader of the party, but yet much of the party rejects him. I mean, just personal thinking is I am, in a funny way, relieved that Congress is Republican, because I think they are more likely to keep rein on him. Let him do certain things, but hold some things back. If it's a Democrat, they might just say, no, I'm not doing anything, and you just stagnate and do nothing. So I'm hopeful that there will be some kind of I'm not sure what the right word is, kind of almost putting the brakes on a bit and some of the more, shall we say, extreme ideas. He's already managed to upset China, and he's not even in power yet by basically acknowledging a message from Taiwan, which you probably know the history of it, always actually seen as being wholly a part of China, and it shouldn't be talked to, because China get very uppity if he's not talking to Taiwan separately to China. And yet Trump's taking messages from Taiwan, and I think that's a good thing, because we should recognise the fact that Taiwan is a separate country and it's not part of the communist Chinese state. But also it's upsetting international relations with one of the most powerful nations on the planet, and the idea of China and America going to war is just terrifying. That would be the end for all of us, I think, if that happened.
Absolutely it would, but, you know, even on a much smaller scale, just the idea of not having trade between those two countries is going to be devastating for our gross national product as well. I mean, there's so many things that can happen in relation to this. I mean, there's not just the idea of global warfare. There's also the idea of warfare over embargoes and trade agreements and everything that can be almost as devastating to a country as if somebody were starting to drop bombs.
Absolutely. I mean, if you look at the interesting thing with High Castle, back to that for a second, is the period of time it's paralleling, because obviously in the early 1960s, in the real reality, our reality, you had the Cuban Missile Crisis that grew almost from nothing within a few days to the point of being virtually a nuclear war. You know, suddenly discovering these missiles were there right under them, your guys' noses. It was like, oh my God, you know, how did this happen? And then the kind of the rhetoric that went with that for a few days, it looked like you were heading for war. No matter what, well, what scale of war was debatable, but it looked like it's heading for war. It was a miracle it didn't happen. But there is that easy, very quickly way of tipping into a very dangerous crisis without even realizing you're actually there. And although nominally we no longer have a Cold War as such, although there is certain speculation that Russia might be up to naughties in American electoral fraud, but that's a matter of debate, obviously, whether that happened or not. But that suggests that we're heading towards a bit of a minor Cold War for a little while at least. I mean, okay, Trump and Putin seem to be friendly, but Putin's not going to be there forever. Well, I don't think he's going to be there forever. So you do wonder, you know, where things are going. But again, just bringing us really up to date. It wasn't that long ago, it looked like Turkey and Russia were at each other's throats, really, because in a serious way. And now we've discovered that they've managed to broker a peace agreement in Syria between Assad's government forces and the rebels, not including ISIS, because they're another matter. But the main rebel bodies and President Assad are actually going to start down and talk about peace negotiations. That's news today. So, you know, things change very quickly when you're not looking sometimes. But as you say, definitely we learn from history how things can happen so quickly and so devastating. I mean, it was only, what, about a week and a half ago, we had the Russian ambassador in Turkey was assassinated, and he was shot at an art gallery. And people were comparing that to the murder of the Archduke Ferdinand by, what's his name? Franz Ferdinand, which started World War One, of course. It's like, is this the start of World War Three? And very quickly, both governments said, no, we're looking to see what's going on here. This is perhaps not what it appears to be. You know, there could be some provocation and some deliberate tactics being played here. So it's fascinating what's going on. Frightening, but fascinating.
It is, and the only thing that I can really say about Donald Trump right now, the only positive thing that I can say about him, is that as long as he's extending his hand to Russia, I have no problem with it. I think that any time you're looking a peace agreement rather than starting some sort of animosity, that can only be a good thing. I mean, I'm sure that Russia does have, intentions, for their own good. But I think that at least people are talking and they're not worried about fighting right now. That's always a good thing.
Absolutely. I agree with you there entirely, although hopefully that doesn't mean he starts to ignore Western Europe, because there has been this comment too about perhaps scaling back their involvement in NATO. Now, I think something like 70% of NATO's sort of equipment and military assets, if you like, are provided by America, so they're going to massively scale back on that. That would be a bit scary for us in Europe. And interestingly, one of the things that was proposed by the people supporting us leave the European Union was that there was a claim that we're building a secret United European Army that would be like centrally governed. Well, if NATO starts to fall apart, we could do with that bloody army being built over in Europe. But we shall see. We'll see what happens. But no, I agree there. That's a definite positive. And I've said that to a couple of people, you know, the fact that this is, because it's so different, it could be the start of something really good in terms of international relations and improving things there. Because obviously, we're concerned in Europe what happens internationally with America. If you guys go bananas and do strange stuff domestically, that's your problem. You know? But if things start to affect the rest of the world, then we're all concerned, obviously. But I mean, I love America and I hope things work out. And that, at least, you know, 8 years' time, whatever happens, he'll be gone. You know, that will be the end of Trump, no matter how bad he might have been. He'll be gone.
That's right.
Maybe all human life has gone. The robots have taken over, but at least he'll be gone.
You know what? If all the robots take over, I hope it's those Westworld robots. And besides, like, the Terminator robots, I think it'll be a lot easier to, yeah.
Yes, I think Westworld is the Westworld guys. You know, we could pretend ourselves.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah. So we're talking about alternate histories and, you know, alternate futures and things and events of the past that have really shaped kind of our understanding of the world around us. And one particular series of events in the late 1800s in East London, you might not necessarily think were particularly important. You know, a series of rather unpleasant murders in a part of London that was particularly lawless and very unpleasant. You know, why would they become so important and iconic? But they have. A series of murders carried out by a man who's now been dubbed Jack the Ripper. I mean, just a brief thing about the wider picture of the story, and we'll talk about this a bit more later on, but, you know, murders were very common in the East End in the 1880s, certainly the second half of the 1800s generally. East London was comparable, really, to the Wild West of America of a similar kind of time frame. It was largely lawless. There were people coming in from all over Europe, from countries of Eastern and Western Europe, from as far afield as Russia, particularly from Russia, actually, quite a lot of Jewish immigrants were coming from Russia, who were escaping a rather, anti-Semitic government and royal family that didn't particularly like Jews. That was also true of parts of other parts of Eastern Europe. So there were a lot of coming over. There were a lot of other people who were coming from sort of lower brackets of income, if you like, from Western Europe, places like from France and Germany. So people were pouring into Europe, into the East End, because at that point it was the height of the British Empire. I mean, we were shipping goods out from all over the world, so they were coming into the docks in Eastern Europe. They were coming into the docks in East London and were being warehoused there, and stuff was being worked through and moving around the country. So a lot of people were getting employed to work on the docks and sort of similar areas in the East End of London. But it was also, despite all this wealth coming into the country from around the world, it was by far the poorest part of the country. So violence was a common feature. There was police forces in existence, of course. They were still fairly early on, but they were very, very undermanned and underfunded. So they couldn't do an awful lot. So the idea of people getting in killed in fights and murders were fairly common. You know, it was a weekly event. But these particular murders...
This was a time of... this was a time of abject poverty, correct? I mean, you would have vast amounts of homelessness, people living in hovels, and you talk about, you know, immigrants coming in. Some of these immigrants happened to be women, and the only commodity that a woman had was her body. And you have these reports of women selling their bodies just to provide food for them to get through another day.
Absolutely. It was often the case that they might have come and had brief employment temporarily in factories making clothes and garments, etc. But then very often those jobs would disappear, and of course there's no welfare state, there's no service there. So many women in particular, would fall into things like prostitution, when what was known as the fourpenny knee trembler, just 4 pence, that's all it cost. And wow. So that was a common feature, unfortunately, of life in the East End in those days. But so you're dealing with an area of poverty and overcrowding with appalling conditions. And the ironic thing was, in the early sort of mid-late 1700s, early 1800s, the East End of London was incredibly wealthy, was quite gentrified. A lot of the buildings that even stood even then were well-built, large townhouses. But what would happen was the sort of the factory owners and the importers, the merchants, lived very close to the docks and would obviously be on hand day to day. But as the businesses grew bigger, they decided to move further away, and the west of London became and still is the most opulent part of London. So the east was left to kind of left its own devices. And a lot of these houses might have been on 3 floors with half a dozen rooms in them, but the rooms were being let out to whole families by this point. You know, you'd easily have 5 or 6 families living in the same building, perhaps 1 room each. So it was massively overcrowded. And it also kind of leans towards the mystery of Jack the Ripper, because places that were so overcrowded and so well lived in, how no one ever saw him, or at least officially no one ever saw him, or how he managed to get away with carrying out these murders as violent as they were, sort of very quickly, very quietly, without being spotted, is part of the mystery, really. I mean, there are, again, we'll go on to this a bit later on, but there are theories around how that could be the case. But I think the best thing we should do, really, now, Ron, is actually look at the murders themselves, how they all really began.
Yeah, I think that's a good idea. Now, speaking about the idea of Jack the Ripper being this kind of nebulous figure, there was actually a cartoon that was published in 1888 that said the nemesis of neglect, Jack the Ripper, when he was depicted as a specter stalking, you know, the poor of the Whitechapel mm-hmm. district, and he was supposed to symbolize social neglect because he didn't seem to really be a flesh and blood figure. But the kind of crimes that were committed definitely points that this was a person that was seriously deranged in some respect.
Absolutely. And interestingly, one of the things that give me 2 moments, it'll come back to me. One of the things that Charles Dickens was trying to point out to the world at large was social deprivation in the East End by the books he was writing. Things like Bleak House and Great Expectations were all based around that notion of, look, the social conditions the poor are living in here. And he actually said that, or someone who was close to him or something along those lines actually said that the Ripper murders in the space of a couple of months did what he'd been trying to do for years with his writing, was highlight just how awful this part of the world was. And it really did bring that sort of crashing home to people. But there was other things going on, which I'll get into as well, why this was picked up so heavily by the press. And it is really because the press at the time picked up on these murders and made such a big deal of it. Now, some of the background to what actually was going on was that the previous summer there'd been a huge riot in Trafalgar Square because of unemployment. There'd been a mass protest about unemployment. And so Charles Warren, who was head of the police, had called in the army to basically break up the protesters, and it turned very violent and very nasty. And from that point onwards, the press were very much against Charles Warren, the leader of the Metropolitan Police, and were doing whatever they could to get him out of office. So the opportunity to make a big deal about a series of unsolved murders was a golden opportunity for them to poke fun at him, say, basically, you're failing in your duty for caring for these people because these murders are happening. So that's one of the reasons why these became so famous. But also, again, there are, when we try not to get too graphic in this, but the descriptions of the victims themselves was pretty awful. You know, this was something almost, well, not unseen, but was very, very unusual. Usual murders in the East End were stabbings or sort of that kind of thing for robbery, you know, stealing items, and basically nothing was stolen from these women. So it wasn't theft. That was clearly wasn't the case. Also, the amount of violence committed on the bodies made it strange, because it clearly wasn't just simple cut of the throat, which is what most of them died from, but other things are happening. But I'll just go into some of the detail of the very first murder that was really seen as being the first Ripper murder, because of course over the years, other people have added other victims to the list, but there really is a strong argument that there are just 5 actual real victims of Jack the Ripper that we can identify as being Polly Nichols was the first. She died on the 31st of August, 1888. Second victim was Annie Chapman, who died on the early hours of the 8th of September, 1888. Then we have what's called the Night of the Double Event, which I'll talk about in detail in a little while, but that was on the 30th of September, 1888, before you have the final murder, which was carried out on the 8th of November, 1888. Now, there are people who would put forward other victims, other murders that took place in the time after the 8th of November, but these days, generally, most people interested in the Ripper, from the angle of the kind of murders, what was being done to the victims, etc., would say that is the 5. These are the 5 real Ripper victims. Murders done before and after that have surface similarities, but when you look at the details, it's highly unlikely to have been the same killer. But these 5, or potentially only 4, and I'll go into why I say that in a little while, are definitely the victims of the guy who became known as Jack the Ripper. But the very first, starting off with Polly Ann Nichols, or Mary Ann Nichols, was on the 31st of August, 1888. She was killed in a street that was quite well used, called... I've got to find the name, I've lost it for a second.
Dean Street. No.
Bucks Row.
Bucks Row, that's right.
Yeah, Bucks Row. She was found on a road called Bucks Row, outside of a small gateway that led into a small yard, basically. She was found lying down beside the fence, and the first person who found her actually thought that she had just simply fallen asleep or was possibly drunk and didn't take a lot of notice of her. A second chap came along called Paul Cross. He thought at first it was a tarpaulin that was just left lying on the road, and when he walked over, he realised it was actually a woman. He thought that she was alive, and apparently thought she moved or stirred as he approached. And obviously concerned, he called out to actually shout out for assistance, and there was a police officer was passing at one end of Bucks Row, and he came down to see what was going on, but the guy who'd found the body went off in the other direction. So the police officer found him on his found the body on his own, and then a second officer joined him soon afterwards. Now, the interesting thing about that body was that, as I say, it was just lying beside the gate. There was no sign of anybody else nearby. And initially, there was no sign of any kind of struggle. They thought she had a throat slit. That was clearly obvious from the blood. But they thought that was as much as was done. And they called for what's called a gurney, which is like a wheelbarrow type thing, to take the body away. It was only when the body was taken to the mortuary and undressed that they discovered this huge gaping wound that was running from the sternum up almost to the breastbone. She'd basically been cut open. I should warn our audience, I am going to be a little bit graphic in some of the things I'm going to talk about. I won't go into too much detail, but I think you need to get an idea of the kind of thing that was going on. So that was the body of the first victim. Say it was the early hours of the morning. She was found on the 31st of August. Now, 31st of August had been, it was the next day, had been the bank holiday. So there were a lot of people out and about. It was apparently quite a nice day, so the weather was good. So we don't know how exactly what had happened to her. She was recognised by, or identified, should I say, by people who knew her as being Polly Nichols, and that she was a prostitute. So in all likelihood, she was attacked by a client. So that was the very first one. Now, roll things forward to the early 2000s, and I'll tell you a funny little story, which I might have mentioned before, but I'll mention it today. Many years ago, about 10 years ago, to cut a long story short, I was in contact, or contacted by, should I say, TAPS, who make the Ghost Hunters program.
All right.
They were coming over to the UK for the first time. They were going to be doing an investigation of a place called the Hellfire Caves, which is sort of north of North London, and a pub called the Viaduct Tavern. Now, I used to run my own investigation team many years ago, and we'd done investigations at both locations. And they basically contacted me to see if I had any information that would be useful for the programme. I told them what I knew and hinted it'd be quite nice to come on the programme with them, but they'd already found somebody else called Barry Fitzgerald, who I happen to vaguely know, and I know he's done a lot more with them after that. They contacted me and said, we're interested in doing a tour of the Jack the Ripper murder sites. Do you know anybody? And I said, well, yeah, me. I know the sites quite well. I've been fascinated by it for years. I used to live in the East End of London. I moved up back in mid-90s, went to university there, and I'd only very recently moved back at this point. And I said, I can take you on a tour of the sites if you're interested. And I said, yeah, sure, that sounds good. So we went to the first murder site at Bucks Row, now called Dorwood Street, which I knew quite well, actually, because there's a Sainsbury's, this big superstore at the end of the road where we used to do our shopping. So I know the street quite well. And interestingly, there are photographs that were taken soon after the murder site. And although where the actual murder itself took place, the buildings there have gone, there is a large building in the background which is still there. And you can actually position yourself exactly where you would have been standing, where the body was found, I should say, in relation to that tall building. And where it is now is a small car park. I mean, literally about five or six cars for some flats nearby. And myself and the producer were just ahead of the rest of the film crew. We're walking along towards the site. And, sorry, excuse me. As we approached, we could see there were two large black guys and a white woman were talking. And it was fairly obvious it was a drugs deal. They were selling her something. And they kind of looked at myself and the producer, and sort of one guy sort of looked at us and sort of kind of stepped forward a bit and thought, oh, hello. Then they saw the film crew, about 10 people with lights and cameras behind us, and they thought, ah, no, we're not staying. So the two guys ran off, understandably, they ran off. But the poor girl was completely out of her head, and she kind of remained, and I stood nearby and was starting to do the first bit of film about saying this is the first murder site. And she kind of wandered over to me in this rather dazed and confused state and looked at me and said, what are you doing here? I said, we're filming a TV program. We're filming a program about Jet the Ripper. Would you like to be a victim? And she looked at me and she screamed and ran off at full speed away from me. So I think she kind of got the wrong end of the stick there.
Right.
So, I mean, by this point, it was kind of dusk, early evening. It's well lit and it's quite a busy bit of roadway now that takes you, say, from Valence Street, I think it is, up to the Sainsbury's. But in those days, there were no street lighting. It's certainly not in the East End. It was pretty much quite dark. There were the occasional gas lamp, but not many of them. So, you know, it was often quite hard to see what was going on. So, say, this body was then taken back to the mortuary and was undressed, and say the first time these wounds were discovered. Now again, it kind of made the local press a little bit. There was no major fuss about it. It was just rather unpleasant, quite nasty murder that had taken place in that area of London. They say people were spoken to, people who lived nearby, and interestingly, they say people were living in the buildings nearby the little gateway where the body was found. Nobody heard a thing. So we had police patrolling at opposite ends of the street of Butch Row, and they heard and seen nothing. The two guys who'd say one person found the body and left it, and the second person found it and found the police. They said they'd heard nothing. I mean, as I say, one guy thought that the woman was still alive, though clearly that wasn't the case, but it suggests that she may have been slightly warm, perhaps had been murdered fairly recently. So that was the first murder. So that was really all it was to it at that particular point. It was reported in the local press as a violent murder, but just one of a number of murders that had been carried out. Any thoughts?
No. I looking over the coroner's inquest, she even had teeth removed, if I'm not mistaken, correct? I mean, this was whoever did this actually took their time. This was not a rush job. This was not a quick apprehension, quick slash, and off the person went. This seemed to be methodical, and there was time taken to perform the type of murder that actually cost this woman her life.
Mm-hmm. Well, certainly the question about the teeth is whether they were recently removed or they were actually happened on the night. I tend to think there may have been something that had probably fallen out more recently rather than been removed. Some of the autopsies are sort of a bit rushed and a bit haphazard because no one really cared. You know, these are low-life prostitutes. No one was that particularly bothered. It was noted that with all the victims, the last one we can't be certain of, but certainly all the others, the death blow was the throat slit and was probably grabbed from behind. It may have been they were led them, their client, to a particular spot that might have been a little bit out of the light, a bit safe. And woman probably might have just turned away, would have been grabbed from behind, probably hand over the mouth, and then the knife was ripped across the throat. So obviously, the head was being pulled one way by the mouth over the hand over the mouth, and the knife pulled in the opposite direction. One coroner suggested that perhaps it was the other way around, that they were cut from the front, but that was a little bit ridiculous to say the woman was grabbed by her chin and then the knife was cut across the throat, facing the person doing it. So almost certainly they were grabbed from behind. They knew where their assailants were, clearly, because they were led to places that were quite dark and quiet. I mean, going on in a minute to our second murder, Annie Chapman, she had been seen previously in that same courtyard where she was found, and other prostitutes had used the same area. Because the houses at the site of the second murder often had little archways that would walk straight through into the rear small garden. These are what they call tenement buildings, so you could walk straight in if you lived there or not. And often people would shelter there from the rain or worse weather with the overhang of the archway. So I'd say the thing that was unusual was the way it was being cut open. And they concluded that the knife was probably quite small, very sharp and probably pointed. So again, you could speculate maybe some kind of small butcher's implement. Or as some have speculated, that it were maybe surgical equipment. But we'll come on to that, why that story has kind of wandered into the mythology of Jack the Ripper. Now it probably isn't the case, but the second.
So the next murder, my friend, we're talking about a week later, 8 days later. When is the next body then discovered?
Well, the murder probably took place either very late on the 7th of September or the early hours of the 8th of September. So you're talking about no more than a week away. And the second murder takes place. Now, the woman herself was found in the backyard of, and I've just lost my notes. Let me hold on a second. I typed myself out earlier and I lost them. Typical.
Hanbury Street.
Yes, thank you. That's the place. Yes, Hanbury Street. So the second victim was found in the back of a house in Hanbury Street. Again, it looks like she'd met her client probably in the street and had gone into this backyard area where she was taken. Now, the body itself was found in the early hours of the morning. Just prior to that, a man by the name of Albert Kadosh had come into the garden next door and had heard what he thought was someone say no and then a thump against the fence. And didn't think much more of it because he maybe thought maybe a fight or some domestic was going on. So he basically went back to bed, having used the toilet outside, and went back to bed. But it sounds quite likely from what he said that that was clearly Annie Chapman being murdered on the other side of the fence. So it was quiet, it was silent. Instead, he just heard her say no, kind of muffled, and then a thump against the fence, as if he'd been obviously grabbed, tried to struggle for a moment, and had a throat cut. Sorry, losing my voice. So she basically collapsed onto the ground, and this is where it starts to get a little bit strange. She says she was found the following morning, and I made a note of the guy who found her, and... She was found 6 o'clock in the morning by a chap called John Davis, who lived there. And he'd gone outside to feed his little pet rabbit in its small cage in the back garden. He found a body lying by the fence. Her feet were pointing towards the back of the garden, head pointing towards the house. She was lying, and he noticed that something was not right about her. She'd basically began being cut open as before, but clothes had been pulled apart, and some of her organs had been taken out. Some had been placed over her shoulder, which is quite unpleasant, which was pretty graphic. Even for those kind of days, that kind of stuff was pretty graphic. One of the things that was noticed by the police when they arrived was there was a leather apron hanging nearby by a tap. So the question was raised, obviously, had this person used the apron? Now, when the police started to ask questions of the locals, they were told that there was somebody whose name was unknown but was nicknamed Leather Apron, had actually been harassing women in the area. So this was the first time any kind of possible suspect was put forward. Again, no one knew the actual name of the guy, but he was only known as by the name of Leather Apron. They began to investigate who this might be, and a name was put forward. I'm having brain death today. I'm forgetting everything. Give me a minute.
No. You know, the name Leather Apron has a great sinister quality to it. I think that that's a great monster name. And I think that, you know, whenever we see like Leatherface from the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, this is kind of coming into play. But Leather Apron simply does not have the same appeal as Jack the Ripper for the headlines.
No, definitely not. So the name Leather Apron had been mandated about as a man who threatened women. Now, they tracked down a guy called John Pizer, who apparently used to wear a leather apron in his work. He was a cobbler. And there have been some accusations in the past that he may have been what we might describe as being unstable mentally, that he may well be responsible for this. But unfortunately, they managed to find that John Pizer himself had been in another part of London on that night of the 7th of September. So he couldn't be Leather Apron. But nevertheless, the name John Pizer and Leather Apron have been put together forever, basically, as being the real Leather Apron. So that kind of got dropped as a lone inquiry at the time, but there's still this question of what was going on. This woman had clearly been cut to pieces quite violently. And there were other things were found with her which might have given some clues to who the murderer might have been. Apparently there were a couple of pills found nearby, a piece of muslin and a comb, which belonged to the victim. There was an envelope, remains of an envelope, were also found nearby, which subsequently was determined had nothing to do with her, with the murder victim, which just happened to be in the grounds of the building. But for a little while, they tried to track down the guy and eventually found the man who belonged to, who apparently was a former soldier of the Sussex Regiment, or at least he claimed to have been and may not have actually been a soldier at all. But again, there was no real evidence that they could use to establish what had actually happened. There were blood splatters on the fence, which is the fence that could had heard the woman fall against, but that was again the only real physical clues they could find. So by this point, this did start to build interest, because this was a second murder of a similar kind, and back in those days the newspapers came out 2 or 3 times a day, so they were like the main source of information. It was like TV is now. They'd often have every few hours a new edition of papers would come out, so people were starting to ask questions and trying to find out more information. And indeed, one witness came forward who said she'd seen the victim with a figure that she described as a shabby, genteel appearance. Now, genteel was a term that was often applied to foreigners, for foreigners read Jewish. So the suggestion was that she'd met with somebody who may be of East European origin or appearance short time before she was murdered. Elizabeth Long was the name of the witness, and again, she seemed to tell the same story to other people when she was at questions about it. So it may be that that was the Ripper himself that she was seen with. But again, nothing much could be determined. Again, the funny thing was, houses on both sides, every room occupied, but no one heard a thing, apart from Albert Kadosh, who'd heard the known thump against the fence. So it certainly seemed to be that whoever he was, the actual murder itself was pretty swift. It was quick. It was very much violent. And in every case but one, the wound to the neck was very, very deep, and it had been speculated that perhaps they were attempting to remove the head. Now, again, we don't know this to be the case or not, because obviously there's no one one has ever quizzed the real Ripper. But certainly the cut was very deep and very quick, so obviously they couldn't speak or struggle, and very quickly would have died. And all the other wounds were post-mortem, were clearly done afterwards. Now, one of the questions that is constantly raised when it comes to Jack the Ripper, which is a total misnomer, is motive. Now, if these murders were happening today, Ron, I think you and I would agree straight away this is a psychopath. There's no coherent motive behind these things. They weren't being done for a particular reason. That kind of murder, psychopathic murders, are carried out because of delusions in the murderer's mind. It's not to do with the real world behind what was happening. But in those days, the whole notion of psychopathology was almost non-existent. And the police of the time, even hot top brass, would never have heard the term before, would have no conception of what a psychopath was. They would have seen these as being murders by a coherent, violent individual for some reason, who had some kind of motivation behind these murders that was a real-world motivation that could be explored and understood. So you have, very early on, this whole area of being explored of why was someone carrying out these violent murders? What logical reason could there be for them? That's the basis of most of the bigger mystery conspiracy theories about the Jack the Ripper identity, because they try to base them around the idea there must be a real world reason why these murders were happening. When in actual fact, any sort of psychiatrist could tell you straight away, no, these murders are to do with internal demons this guy's dealing with, most likely of a sexual nature, perhaps abused, or at least was dominated by a mother or mother figure when he was young, and he's basically exacting revenge on all women based on his own personal experiences when he was a child. I mean, you know, as someone who's a psychotherapist myself, that makes sense to me. But because it was completely beyond the realms of understanding in those days. I mean, you had Sigmund Freud writing by this point, but it still was very, very early in his career. So the idea of a psychopath wouldn't have meant anything. The whole idea of a crime motivated by any kind of sexual deviancy would be abhorrent. We're talking about Victorian England here. You know, the idea of wearing a skirt above the ankles was seen as, you know, well, that's too much, can't do that. So to even talk about things like sexually motivated crimes was an absolute no-no. So it is fascinating how this notion of there being a logical reason for these murders has been the basis of so many different books and theories, yet it's completely superfluous.
And that's a good point, Andy. I mean, that starts right from where we began the show, is that we have to talk about perspective when we deal with history. We're dealing from a 21st century perspective and looking back and trying to analyze why these particular murders happened. I mean, we did the same thing with Shakespearean characters. For a while, you know, the idea of Iago was he was a motiveless malignancy as identified by W.A. Jordan. And for a while, you know, people have speculated why did, you know, certain characters act the way that they did. But it's interesting when we deal with the world of psychology that we go back now and we try to find this particular figure that we now call Jack the Ripper and try to analyze him as best we can and kind of get it to the very root of why his psychopathic tendencies manifested themselves this particular time in 1888.
Mm-hmm, exactly. You know, that whole spurious notion of, well, what's the reason behind that? Well, there isn't one that you can sort of say it's because of this. I mean, some of the theories that we can perhaps talk a bit more later on include the idea that she was one of a number of nursemaids who cared for a certain royal infant, that they all had the secret about who the father was of this infant, and they had to die because they knew. You know, that's just ridiculous. But yeah, it was one of the strongest stories, should we say, of the Ripper murders, which was based around the book by Stephen Knight, which came out in the 1970s, I think it was. And it's just absolute raving nonsense. I mean, we'll get on to a bit later how that whole story came about, but it's become, in many ways, one of the most popular theories that there's some kind of royal conspiracy. In fact, the film From Hell, which you may have seen a few years back with Johnny Depp in the role of Inspector Abilene, who was a genuine real police officer who's nothing like the character that Johnny Depp plays, that's all based around this royal conspiracy story. And Alan Moore, who wrote the book, wrote the graphic novel, I should say, From Hell, said, you know, it's just my take on things. It's nothing to do with reality whatsoever. But yet people see that film and say, oh, that's what really happened. There was a royal conspiracy. And it's like, oh, my God, you know, that's the most ridiculous version available. But yet you know, people like conspiracies. They love a good conspiracy, and truth and conspiracy are really together. But so you have the two murders taking place, both which clearly have very violent acts being carried out on the bodies post-mortem after death. Both coroner's reports agree that the knife was probably between 6 and 8 inches long and thin and very sharp. And sharp probably to a point that was carried out. There was one report suggesting there may be links to anatomical knowledge, which was something we'll come back to a bit later on, because that's been a strong misnomer about this whole case. The next murders are the ones that really start pointing fingers towards doctors. Now, this is the night of what they call the night of the double event. Now, this is quite a strange set of experiences that happened that night. It's I'm just pausing a sec to turn off. I could tuck up my old notes, Ron. I actually found the notes I wrote up when I did the show with Taps. Would you believe it? More than 10 years ago, I actually found them again.
Oh, very cool.
Yeah, I must have found them again. I've added a bit more to them just to kind of remind myself what the hell I was talking about. So you move on to the next third and fourth victim, or maybe just the third. And I'll get into that in a minute. This is the night of the 30th of September. Now, there's been a few weeks since the previous murder because people are starting to take notice and are starting to be concerned. There are forming vigilance committees, people going out looking for the Ripper, and the police have increased their presence on the ground because these stories are now getting into the press. Indeed, I should say it's at this point that we start getting towards the name of Jack the Ripper, where it first starts to appear. So, yeah, the first time that name, Jack the Ripper, was applied was actually just before the double event. And this is the interesting thing, because this letter was actually received by the Central News Agency on the 27th of September. Now, it'd been a couple of weeks since the second murder, so it was almost like the press wanted to keep this story in the news. There is debate, endless debate, over the nature of these letters. There are a few of them, but I am absolutely convinced, and I think most serious Ripper researchers are convinced, that the Ripper himself wrote none of these letters. He was probably unlikely to have had that good a command of English to begin with, and secondary, it just doesn't gel with a serious psychopathic murderer who then start writing letters like this. But I'm going to read this letter out to you entirely. It was written in Reading and received by the Central News Agency, who would then sell news stories onto various other newspapers, the actual newspapers themselves. And it reads, "Dear boss, I keep on hearing the police have caught me, but they won't fix me just yet. I have laughed when they look so clever and talk about being on the right track. That joke about leather apron gave me real fits." Now, if you remember, we were talking before about this leather apron as the first kind of suggested identity for the Ripper, but this guy's clearly saying, "It's not me, I'm not leather apron." Now, the language gets a bit strange here. "I'm down on whores and shan't quit ripping them till I do get buckled." Now, quite a few researchers have said the use of the word "shan't quit" and "buckled" particularly tend to be American terms as being arrested. Now, obviously, you're American, you have a better idea then, but of that time, the term "buckled" seemed a little bit odd. Anyway, this letter goes on. "Grand work with the last job was. I gave the lady no time to squeal. How can they catch me now? I love my work and want to start again. You'll soon hear from me my funny little games. I've saved some of the proper red, underline red, stuff in a ginger beer bottle over the last job to write with, but it went thick like glue and I can't use it. Red ink is fit enough, I hope. Ha ha. Next job I shall do, I'll clip the lady's ears off and send them to the police just for jolly, wouldn't you?" Again, it's weird language. It's not kind of any level of East End kind of speech. It's odd. "Keep this letter back and do some more work, then give it out straight. My knife's so nice and sharp. I want to get to work straight away if I get a chance. Good luck. Yours truly." Here it comes. Jack.
Yep.
Jack the Ripper. "Don't mind me giving the trade name. P.S. Wasn't good enough to post before I got the red ink off my hands. Curse it. No luck yet. They say I'm a doctor now. Ha ha." Again, so whoever wrote this clearly knows what's in the press, because they're talking about leather apron, they're talking about being a doctor. So, you know, again, it's unlikely the Ripper would have read this or written this. If you see the original letter itself, you can find it on the internet. It's quite well written, good handwriting, you know, the spelling's all correct. None of these things would be what you would expect for this kind of psychopath. Now, we've had psychopath killers who are very intelligent, very erudite. I mean, Ted Bundy was probably the most famous example of someone very intelligent, was clearly a serial killer. But this kind of ripping apart, this kind of violent, destructive murder doesn't tend to happen that way, that they would then be writing letters to the press. I mean, again, other examples would be the Zodiac killer, who used to write in code to the it's Los Angeles or San Francisco, but to the police there. But again, his murders were very quick and simple. They were shot, there were single stabs, that kind of thing. This slow, nasty ripping apart. Well, I say slow, it was probably pretty quick, but this very deliberate ripping apart of a body is not the sort of thing that a person would then write these letters would do. But that name, Jack the Ripper, it's just struck chords of everybody. Until this point, it was known as the Whitechapel murders. In fact, they were still filed as the Whitechapel murders. But Jack the Ripper, that just had the ring of, whoa, that's perfect. And so, of course, you get 2 days or 3 days later, you get this double event occurring. It seems almost as if the Ripper was predicting it. And there's a particular line that's interesting, because it's about clipping the lady's ears off just for jolly. The second victim on the double event night, she did have a cut in her ear. One side was cut, probably with a knife, again with a throat slit, and the other side was ripped from an earring that had fallen out, or ripped out, some time before. But it gave the impression that the Ripper knew more than he was claiming, or the writer knew more than was in the press. But again, it's just the way you read these things. But getting on to the victims themselves, the first victim of the night was a woman called Elizabeth Stride. She's of Swedish descent, living over here, and was actually quite tall. She was about 5'6", which for a woman in those days in East Ham was quite tall. She was often known as Longley Stride. What happens with her is a little strange, and it's why I keep saying about maybe there was only four victims, because I do raise the question, it's not just me, others have said the same of this particular victim, that she may not have been a Ripper victim. It takes place in what's called Duffield's Yard, which is down what is now called Henrique Street. And what is actually seen is by the guy who lives in Duffield's Yard. Now, his name is Louis Diemschutz, and him and his wife together run a drinking club. It was like a socialist social club of East European descent, and it was a kind of meeting house getting together. With, essentially, it was a sort of off-the-books pub, if you like, which just sort of local people would gather there. He was returning from the market, and he was riding his pony and trap into the back of Duffield's Yard, his courtyard area, and he saw a woman's body lying on the ground. He thought, first of all, it was his wife, and she was probably drunk. He didn't disturb the body, he just left her there, and went inside. When he found his wife inside, and quite sober, we're talking with people in the club, she realised, obviously, it wasn't his wife. So he went outside to see what was going on, and he found the woman's body. Now, interestingly, what he said was, and again, the police autopsy confirmed this, the woman had been cut across the throat, but lightly, not deep, the way the other victims had been cut. The autopsy suggested the knife was a long, wide-brimmed, wide blade with a rounded end to it. A different kind of knife to what had been used in the previous victims. Both the first two victims, it was very much a long, thin blade sharpened to a point. This had a round end to it. It was a different kind of knife. Talking to locals nearby, someone had noticed a woman having an argument with a man standing nearby Duffield's Yard entrance. And there's a bit of confusion because one witness says that the man grabbed the woman and pulled her towards the yard into the dark. Another witness said the man pulled the woman away from it. And somebody at some point shouted at that woman and man, Lipsky, that was the word, so I forgot for a second. And Lipsky was referenced to a poisoner who'd murdered a woman and the woman's mother in a nearby street the previous year. He was their landlord and poisoned them to death. And anyone who was sort of kind of a bit of a ruffian who looked might be Jewish, Lipsky was used as a term of insult. Now, that suggests possibly the man that was pulling the woman either towards Duffield's Yard or away from it was Jewish in appearance. I don't know, you know, speculating because of the use of the term. But that was the last time she was seen. Now, that was probably no more than about 15, 20 minutes before Diemschutz came home. So it's been suggested that as Diemschutz came into Duffield's Yard, he may have disturbed the Ripper and he may have been hiding in a dark corner somewhere waiting for Diemschutz to leave. Now, I'm not convinced. I do find the fact that the woman was only cut across the throat lightly, and the fact that the knife used sounds like it was different to the one the Ripper had. The first two victims clearly were Ripper victims, the way they'd been killed. So, to me, it opens the question of, was this actually Jack the Ripper himself? Now, the reason why people have said it is what happened 40 minutes later. about no more than a quarter of a mile away in Mitre Square. Now, before I go on to that second murder, what do you think, Ron, what I'm saying there?
Well, the knife that you said was used in the first murders was about 6 inches long, correct? Because that was the general consensus.
Yes.
And then we're looking – now, the idea of a copycat, is that a possibility in this case? I know we talk about copycats a lot in contemporary society, but is that something that could have been going on in this particular case?
I think it's entirely possible. As you were saying already, the news coverage was – yeah, again, had been lifted up because of this newsletter that had appeared. So it was back in the news again. It was only a matter of a few weeks ago that the first murder had happened. Newspapers are being printed 2 or 3 times a day. So it's quite possible that someone might even try to disguise their own actions and try and blame the Ripper for what's being done, because it would possibly have been sucked into the Ripper murders. And this is an example. I do think, and I know I'm not the only one who thinks this, that this may well not be a Ripper murder at all, and it's got dragged in because of what happened 40 minutes later.
Right. See, that's an interesting thing to me, that we're talking about psychosis, and that's something that would not have been taken into account back in 1888. Mm-hmm. But we know from today that, you know, something in the newspaper, something in the media can always set somebody off that's right, you know, very tenuous existence. You know, they're straddling the line between reality and insanity. Something like that's happening in the newspapers could easily set somebody off. And then also we have the notion of racism, or, you know, the idea of, you know, of some sort of hatred against the Jews now being popularized. So there's different reasons this murder may have indeed taken place.
Absolutely. And we do get into that same area that, as well as having the newspaper presses, they will build posters put up around you asking for information, because that was obviously how the police got the word out to people. You know, do you know anything about these killings, Whitechapel murders, as it was described? And they weren't called publicly by the police Jack the Ripper murders at all. The Whitechapel killings, the Whitechapel murders. So these posters were being stuck out all over the East End. So it was really was, you know, pardon me, it really was in the public eye. So there's a very good chance that you're talking about a copycat, at least unintentional copycat even, you know, the fact that you just happened to look similar. So the person carrying out the murder didn't necessarily do it to make it look like it was Ripper's murder, but because it was a throat slit, then it's Ripper murder. Again, some of the details about the sheer violence of the killings had been held back from the public and the press. If you could go along to the inquest, anyone could go along to it, but not many people would do, of course. So unless you went to the inquest itself, you wouldn't hear all the details. But some of the details were in the press, but not all of it. So, you know, it could be that it's just by sheer chance of coincidence, not even a deliberate coincidence. But going on to the second murder of the night, now this definitely was a Ripper murder. This happens only, say, 40 minutes later in Mitre Square, which is literally a stone's throw from Fenchurch Street Station. So I've been there many times. Mitre Square is the only site that has any kind of resemblance to the original site, how it would have looked when the murders happened. All the others have changed beyond recognition. I mean, as I say, the first murder site, the Robes' name was changed. Nothing to do with the murder. It was just the way the layout of London was being redesigned. But say the buildings have largely gone, apart from that block that's nearby, which at the time was a school. I'm not sure what it is now, but it still stands. Second site was completely demolished, and Hanbury Street was replaced with a brewery that stood there for many years. That now has been demolished and replaced by a car park, so that's changed. Although, interestingly, if you're ever in London, if you go to the next street over from Hanbury Street, there are houses that look very similar to Hanbury Street would have looked. Indeed, Ron, if you ever come over, I'll take you on a tour. But so it has that similarity.
I remember the first time that I went to Whitechapel, and it was, of course, for the Ripper murders, you know. And you go there, and you see whenever the idea of immigration and such, there's a lot of languages spoken in Whitechapel, isn't there? I mean, there's a lot of open markets, and everywhere you see advertisements for immigration lawyers. So we do see a shadow of what it must have been like, you know, the crowded corridors and the notion of there's so many different languages being spoken, and just a race of humanity trying to vie for that little bit of salvation that a job would provide, or just to get through another day of obtaining food. And then you also have the Royal London Hospital right there, right, standing guard over all this stuff. And if I'm not mistaken, this is actually the same time as the Elephant Man, correct?
I mean, oh, absolutely, this, yeah. Absolutely hidden hype in the North Tower of the hospital. Yeah, it's very much the same time frame. Interesting.
So, like I said, my first impression with Whitechapel must have only been a mere shadow of what it had to have been in the 1880s. But it was very congested. I really had this sense of disorientation because I didn't know where, one street led to and where the other was, going to. So, I mean, for me, and this happened in 1999, which was the first time I visited Whitechapel, you could imagine what it must have been in 1888. But, this was one of the things that makes this story so intriguing, even now, why we're talking about this even to this very time, is because it matters to us for some reason, because this was the first time that, the idea of the serial killer started to make press.
Yes, absolutely. That is, you've hit the nail on the head really there. It is the first really well-documented case of serial killing. Now, for some reason, we are fascinated by murder and death. Look at enough TV channels that cover this kind of thing and the films that get made. So, we have this. I think we're also fascinated by the otherness, the idea of what's going on in the head of someone like that. We live ordinary lives, pretty safe. And, there are people out there who have very different ideas in their minds about how the world's supposed to be and what they're experiencing themselves. And I think the otherness of the fascination for people as well.
Yeah, in Whitechapel at this time, that's a good point, because I like to talk about liminal zones, this area between the civilized and the uncivilized, and Whitechapel was a bit of that. When we talk about the Victorian England and the sun never set on the empire, which was true because it spanned the complete breadth of the globe, you're talking about an absolute abundance of wealth, but there was the haves and there was the have-nots, and people kind of turned their eye. They didn't want to look at Whitechapel. And the Ripper murders, like you had stated about an hour ago, the Ripper murders and Charles Dickens was actually shedding a light onto this undercarriage of society that people did not want to admit was right there outside their door.
Absolutely, it was. It was almost like a black hole. You'd skirt around the East End, you wouldn't get near it if you could possibly avoid it. And if you were into the East End, that was it. You're stuck there. There was no way out again. I mean, it was argued that parts of the East End were the poorest parts of the entire empire, compared to even places sort of in Africa or India in those days, that this was even worse than there. But you do find, I think that's one of the fascinations, that whole concept of this sort of dark underbelly of sort of Victorian society, especially, that was so kind of prim and proper. You have this kind of monstrous murderer wandering around carrying out these violent crimes. And just going back to the Mitre Square murder, this, again, because it's so easy to get to from Fenchurch Street, often if I go to London, when I was living here in Basel, I'd go up to London and shopping for the day or whatever, I'd just go to Mitre Square and sort of stand there for 5 minutes, because the cobbles you stand on are the same cobbles. They haven't changed. They've not been replaced. The buildings around the square have changed, apart from the school, which is still there, but three of the four sides have changed. There used to be warehouses and now they're offices, but the square itself hasn't changed. But the interesting thing about the previous murder that night, Liz Stryer on Duffield's Yard. If you go there now, the road's called Henrique Street. Duffield's Yard has gone. There's a school standing there, but someone rather cheekily painted, last time I was there, painted on the wall a picture of a gate. And underneath, Jack the Ripper was here, which I thought was quite funny. But when I took my wife there for the very first time, because she's grew up in the East End from Bethnal Green, she said, my parents got married in the building across the road. So that was quite amazing. It used to be the Oxford and St George Club. It was a Jewish club. My wife's Jewish. And the parents got married at a registry office, then had their Jewish ceremony at this building in Henrique Street. It was literally opposite the Ripper murder site. And she had no idea. She's like, bloody hell. My parents got married there.
And if I'm not mistaken, the 10 Bells is still in existence, isn't it?
It is. It's much reduced in size compared to the original 10 Bells. It used to fill up half the high street, but now it's much, much smaller. Incidentally, a little side story. The first time I went around the sites back in the 80s, I decided to pop in the 10 Bells because it was the 10 Bells. And it was bizarre because the wall was covered in newspaper cuttings, old ones, obviously, reproductions and photographs, not the violent photographs, but the photographs of the murder sites and information on Jack the Ripper there. And there was a stripper. And I thought, this is just bizarre. This woman's stripping right in front of these posters. I mean, it's a bit of a CD pub then, CD pub now. But to be surrounded by references to Jack the Ripper, a sexual serial killer, and stripping No, that was just weird. I walked out. This is just too weird for words. Something get the bizarre irony of this. I left it in fairly quick measure, I have to say. I'm not a prude, but I don't approve that kind of thing. In the middle of a sort of a dull afternoon, shall we say. It wasn't some sexy nightclub. It was just some rather seedy pub. And I'm not staying here. But it was just the weird sense of all these pictures and this woman was taking her clothes off. Oh, no.
Yeah, the very odd juxtaposition of that.
That's the word I was looking for. Thank you. That's the word. But getting back to this rather nasty murder, this is effectively the fourth in terms of the classic chronology of murders. She was found, Kathy Eddowes, and she's lying beside what is now a slightly raised garden, but or wasn't there at the time, but it's like in one corner of the square. Again, in probably the only part of the square that wasn't that well lit, there were a couple of gas street lights nearby, but this is probably the least well lit area. It's similar kind of state, unfortunately, to the previous victim of the previous night, I should say, back in the 30th of September, not Miss Stry's body. Again, throat very cut very deeply with the same long, thin blade. So you are left with the question, well, if Stry was killed with a different kind of knife, he's now gone back to his usual knife. That makes no sense. But again, clothes ripped open. She was cut basically from top to bottom, shall we say, right up to her throat, and was literally pulled open, and most of the internal organs again were taken out and dumped to the side, literally just emptied out is probably the best way of putting it. Now, the first doctor who came to view the body at the site said that one of the cuts to remove a particular organ, I won't go into the details because it's too graphic, but he said was very well done, very neat, which was where the idea that the ripper was a doctor really started to begin to take shape. The fact that the other end of this particular organ had been cut away, savagely ripped out, and bits were remaining was almost forgotten. So he was probably just a lucky cut the first time, and the second, the other end of the organ was a complete mess. But it started to add to this fuel of the idea of being a doctor. That letter that we read out before had now been gone into the public. So this idea again of this is by the real Ripper, calling himself Jack the Ripper, and he's a doctor, ha ha. But is he a doctor? Because the next person who examined the body at the mortuary said, no, there's no evidence whatsoever here of any medical knowledge at all. But yet the idea started to stick that he was a doctor. You know, even though it's contrary to what most of the other researchers have said, including the people who saw the body, this idea of him being a doctor started to grow and has become a bigger thing. So you do find people who will tell you that Ripper was a doctor, even though the evidence is almost non-existent. It's just literally from one real report that it was a doctor. So you have these two victims, both taking place within about 40 minutes of each other. Now, what was interesting was they noticed that nearby is an alleyway that led away from the square. Now, there had been a police officer had been nearby one end of the square and had seen three businessmen who had emerged from a drinking establishment near to the square, would have come through the square and past the policeman. Now, the three guys probably wouldn't have seen the body from the position it was laying to where they would have walked. There were three Jewish businessmen, and they walked past the police officer, and the police officer said hello. Now, there are some reports that somebody else emerged from there. Now, they've not been able to trace who that might have been, but the only other way out was his archway. So they started to think, well, if he hasn't come out the way these three business people have gone past, they haven't passed him, he must have gone the other way. So they start to follow out the trail and check out the roads nearby. Now, what's interesting, one of the alleyways they go into exploring to try and find possibly the murderer, again, some reports of there being blood found in a standing sink, which is like a public wash basin, if you like, out in the street, that may have had blood in it. Now, again, not been substantially definite, but there's been suggestions. But what was definitely found nearby was a piece of Kathy Eddowes clothing that had blood and feces on it that looked like the killer must have used to clean his hands and had dropped as he'd run away. So they had had a sense of the direction he must have gone. Unfortunately, and it is unfortunate, the alleyway in which he'd gone through and dropped this piece of cloth, there was something written on the wall. It was drawn in chalk. Now, it was noted by the police officer who saw it and Sir Charles Warren, the guy we talked about before, because obviously this has been becoming quite a big case, that it looked like it had been there for some time. It wasn't fresh, it wasn't new, but the wording has been used by some to suggest a dark conspiracy being behind the murders. And the wording was, now there are again slightly different versions of the wording, but the street was found, it was called Golston Street, and the graffiti read, "The Jews are the men who are not to be blamed for nothing," or "The Jews are not the men who would not be blamed for nothing." There is different versions, but what's most interesting is the spelling of the word Jews. Now, we assume they're talking about Jews as in J-W-S, but it was spelled J-U-W-E-S. Very odd spelling of the word. And it has been suggested that this is referencing to Freemasonry lore about the Jews who were betrayed, betrayed Solomon, were building the Solomon's Temple. That's been suggested that this it is a link to Freemasons. Now, the fact of the matter is, some people have even suggested that Jack the Ripper himself stopped and wrote this on the wall before he ran on, which makes absolutely no sense. You know, you're fleeing from your murder scene. You go through an archway, you drop a piece of cloth, and you write something on the wall, and then carry on running. But it doesn't make any sense, does it? But, and as I say, the police officer who saw it said it was old, had been there for some time. Now, it's just beginning to break through to dawn. Now, as we were saying before, there'd already been these reports of linking the Gentile, i.e. Jewish person, to the murders. So the idea that an Englishman would never carry out these kind of murders was spreading about a bit. And some of these vigilance committees and patrols were targeting Jewish people or foreign-looking people of any kind and beating them up on the street. So the idea that this wording would be written in chalk on a wall in an area that was about to get very busy as the dawn came, suggested that it wouldn't be a good idea to leave this writing here, especially when this piece of apron's been found and the police have been spotted nearby. So Charles Warren ordered it to be rubbed off and removed. I think quite sensibly, although it would have been better if a photograph had been taken before it was removed to clarify, one, the state of the writing, and two, what it actually said, because there is slight variations. But those of some people who are more conspiracy minded have chosen to believe that it was proof that there was a dark conspiracy going on, and that Warren was instructed to try and hide the fact that the Jews, or the Freemasons, because of the weird spelling of Jews, were actually involved. Again, that's rather crazy, but, you know, these ideas start to really take off.
That's right. That's the whole idea of revisionist history, isn't it?
Absolutely. Unfortunately, very much that is the case. So following that, you had the Ripper was back in the headlines, very much so. And obviously now with his new name, Jack the Ripper, this violent murder was worse than anything he'd been seen previously. He'd obviously had quite a bit of time because the square was closed in on three of the four sides. There was only about two ways in and out. There was actually so it was surrounded by warehouses. And one of the warehouses, the night watchman was there all night with his door open with a small fire burning. And he heard and saw nothing, which was amazing, really. But again, if he was coming up behind these women, grabbing them, obviously he had led them to dark, secluded spots, because that's obviously where they did their business, and was then grabbed by the Ripper and throat slit very deep, very quickly, then, of course, there'd be silence very, very quickly. And he's, of course, still holding the body so he could lower it to the ground. You know, one of the things people say was, why anyone be spotted with covered in blood? But if he's cutting through both the arterial and the ventricle veins in the neck from behind, with the person facing forward, the blood would go shooting out forward, as was the case, and was seen on the ground. It wouldn't have splattered all over the murderer. So that by the time you lower them to the ground, the force of the blood would have slowed down, and he was unable to do what he did without getting too much blood on himself. So, you know, you wouldn't have had him covered in blood. So we have the fourth, or possibly third, murder taking place. Now, of course, as we were saying before, you have this whole reference to ears being cut off. Now, this became a real feature now, the fact that this woman had apparently had her ears nicked, but probably just by the blade of the knife. It wasn't a deliberate attempt. But another letter arrived at the Central News Agency, which appeared to be within the same handwriting, was the same red ink as the first letter I read out. So I'll read this one to you now, because it does make reference to the ears. It reads, "I was not codding, dear old boss, when I gave you the tip. You hear more about Saucy Jackie's work tomorrow." Saucy Jackie, again, a strange reference. Double event this time. So it seems to confirm that this was actually two murders by the Ripper. But we're pretty certain, I'm pretty certain these letters were not written by the Ripper himself, but he was going on with the general news media idea of these two murders, 40 minutes apart, must be the same person. Yeah. Number one squealed a bit and so couldn't finish the job straight off. Now, we know for a fact there was no sound made by Lestrade because there were people around who saw what was happening and never heard a thing. So the squeal a bit is obviously is an error, but it might explain why he didn't finish her straight off. But again, this guy wouldn't have known that there was a problem with the way she was killed. Had not time to get ears off for police. Thanks for keeping this letter back until I will do my work again. Yours, Jack the Ripper. Interesting, he said number one squealed a bit and couldn't finish off and had not time to get ears off for police. So the writer is referencing the first murder, not the second murder that night. So again, it starts to say, well, I think it's just a coincidence and this guy's actually identified the wrong murder for the ear being cut off. So I find that, again, suggests that these letters are not genuine at all. This was postmarked and received on the 1st of October, which, you know, was 2 days later. Now they're saying, well, how it must have been the murderer who did this, who wrote this letter, because it was so soon afterwards. But there were two or three posts every day. You know, postal service was, like, brilliant in those days. So it's quite possible the murder would have been reported in the press the first day the next morning. This guy saw the press, wrote his postcard, sent it off, and it was received the same day. It's quite possible in London in those days, because the post service was, even in the East End, magnificent. So the chances are he's just read it in the press and written his sort of follow-up letter. What's interesting also is the period of time between the murders is starting to expand. Now, that's probably more to do with the fact that the people are starting to take real notice now that these murders are very unusual. The violent nature of them is something you don't normally see. The idea that these women are the lowest of the low and don't really matter was being played up in the press as well as being kind of political. So you've got, on the one hand, you're trying to build up a case against Charles Warren as being incompetent to get him kicked out of his job. It was being used to highlight the fact that the police service in the area is not very well served at all, that they need more men on the ground and they're not getting proper funding for that, that these women are our women that are being cut up, and if it was someone rich and famous being attacked, then the army would be brought in to look after them, but because it's our women, no one cares. So it was really starting to move things forward. It was having some very unusual effects, and I think, by and large, the murderer himself, I probably had no clue about any of what was going on, that he was just doing what he was doing, but he was definitely getting harder and harder for him to track down a victim, because even the women themselves were, you know, being more careful and more guarded. They tend to go out in groups of two or three, only going off at the last minute with a punter that all three of them or the two of them would have seen the person that, say, Jill was going off with, for example. They'd all seen who she was with before, and women were not working on their own anymore, so it was getting harder and harder to find a lone person you could attack and become the next victim of the Ripper. But what happens next with the last victim is pretty horrendous. This is November the 9th now we've come to, or rather probably November the 8th, the night of. Mary Jane Kelly was the victim. She was a little unusual compared to the others because she didn't work in the street. She actually worked from a little home that she had. She was on Dorset Street, which at the time was probably the darkest, dingiest, nastiest part of the whole of the East End. It was the home of criminals and gangs and all. It was a very nasty area. She had a little single room she rented. Previously, she'd rented it with a partner who lived with her for a while, and he'd gone off. Then she let it out with another woman. She shared it for a while, and she'd then gone off. By this point, Mary Jane Kelly was living there on her own. Now, there are reports of Mary Jane Kelly being seen earlier in the evening with a number of different men. The last one that she was seen with is described as wearing quite a large coat, quite a big furry coat with a large collar on him. Again, looking possibly East European or foreign, and possibly carrying a bag. This might have been the beginning, or at least a reference towards the idea again of being a doctor. This was a medical bag he was carrying. Indeed, previously, Elizabeth Stride had been seen with a man who was carrying a parcel wrapped in paper, which again has been suggested might have been the doctor's bag in disguise. In actual fact, they discovered later on that she and another of this man had bought some grapes from a nearby cellar. And in actual fact, she had remains of grapes in her stomach when she was autopsied. But it looked like there may have been a number of hours before, so it was unlikely to have been the buyer of the grapes who was the actual killer. It may have been just a previous client earlier in the evening. So Mary Jane Kelly had been seen with this man, and it was the last person probably to have seen her live with this man. What happened was the following morning was actually the Lord Mayor's show. And the streets were going to be quite busy with people getting ready for the Lord Mayor's show. It's a big parade they have annually in London. And Mary Jane Kelly's landlord, or rather the guy that was rent collector for the landlord owned several properties, came to Kelly's to collect the overdue rent. Knocked on the door, couldn't get any answer. He looked through the very dirty window and could see there was somebody in the bed, or in the room, I should say, on the bed, but couldn't see an awful lot. Now, one corner of the window had been broken and an old jumper had been stuffed in to fill the gap. When he pulled the jumper out of the gap, he could see fully into the room, and what he saw was truly horrendous. Now, there is actually photographs on the net, which you can find. If you put Mary Jane Kelly into Google and look for images, you will find the images of her. And it's almost impossible to make out that that's a human being, apart from the fact you can see a few bones and arms, because it's an absolute mess. Sorry, guys, I'm going to be a bit graphic and give you a bit more of a detail of the state she was in. Basically, she had pretty much all the flesh from her face had been removed. And her eyes were sort of left kind of staring out this face. Nose obviously been cut off. Most of her chest and stomach had been removed and emptied out. In fact, her breasts were found on the table beside her, been cut out and just placed on the table. Some of her stomach and organs had been lazily laid around the room in sort of just haphazard fashion. The flesh had been cut from both of her thighs, one right back to the bone. Again, you can see in the photograph. Some of the body parts appear to have been possibly burnt in the fire. Certainly a number of clothing items that had belonged to Kelly and the woman who stayed there previously had been burnt in the fire, maybe to produce light, but there were candles nearby that hadn't been lit, so exactly why they were burnt is a bit of a mystery. But that was it. She was obviously very, very dead indeed. And what it basically meant was, because it was inside, the killer had had all the time he wanted to do whatever he wanted to do. I mean, he probably would have taken quite a bit of time to do as much damage to Mary's body as he'd done. It was an absolute appalling state. And even the photographs are old, grainy, and black and white. They're quite disturbing to look at. There are two in total. One very famously shows a full-length body of a sort of from the angle of the window, which she was seen through, and kind of the face is turned towards us, but it's not even recognizable as a face. It's just, I mean, I'll be honest, I've looked at this photograph many times, and like, you can't even make out a face. You know, you really can't. Any features are just completely gone.
Exactly. It looks like a massacre. It looks like a psychopathic killer went in there and just, destroyed a human being. And it basically is, that's what had happened. There's no sign of humanity left in Mary Jane Kelly. Mm-hmm. And the interesting thing about this victim is, of all the canonical murders, all the canonical victims, she was the youngest, correct? I mean, this was just a girl. By all accounts, she was very beautiful. She wasn't, like the 45s, 46-year-old other victims. This was a very young woman who was a quite beautiful person, and she was basically denigrated into something no more than discarded pieces of flesh.
Absolutely, a total mess. It was just unbelievable. So many of the police officers who saw it just have never forgotten her. You know, that sight was just horrendous. Many interesting features of this, of course, but one of the interesting things was they're actually trying to trace Mary Jane Kelly herself. She obviously, she stated that she was from Ireland originally, but they've never actually managed to identify her family or find exactly where she was from. She may have spent some time in France, taken there by a client, and she may well have had one or two more better-off clients, but had kind of slipped down the sort of social ladder of prostitution down to the point where she was now living in the most squalid part of the East End. But she was only 25 years old, she was certainly mid-20s. But that was it. That was the last murder. No murder of its similar kind occurred for many years afterwards. There were other murders, I say, who've been attributed to Jack the Ripper, but more detailed examination of the nature of the killings suggests that it's someone or something else has happened. This one itself remains a mystery, as in why it stopped.
Yes, yes. So I think there, my friend Andy, I think this is the perfect time to actually stop and segue into another part of the Jack the Ripper mythology and look at possible other victims as well as possible, the murders, the possible identity of some of the murders.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Sure.
I don't know what else to say about that, but I think that that would be a good way to segue into part number two of the Jack the Ripper killings.
Absolutely. I think we've covered as much detail without being too gory and too gruesome as the nature of these killings. Of course.
Well, the internet is out there. If you want to look up all the gruesome details, you know, feel free to do that. It's out there. There's plenty of coroner inquests, and there's plenty of grainy black and white footage that you have said. So have at it if somebody so desires to dig into this a little bit deeper. Mm-hmm. No pun intended.
Absolutely not. Well, I think we can safely say that most serious ripperologists, as they call themselves, would agree that these are the five. There are no other murders that fit the profile, and they don't. You know, there were subsequently for about the next 3 years, every time there was a violent killing of any kind, it was like, it's Jack the Ripper, but no, it doesn't add up. Somehow, for some reason, some way, the November the 9th was the last one, and it raises the question, of course, then, well, who was Jack the Ripper? The theories run into the hundreds of identities, and we're going to cover a fair few of them in our next show. We're going to go into more detail about, again, some of the clues that were available, were visible when you really dig into the murders themselves, that point in the direction of possible individuals who may have been involved. We know that there are named individuals that the police, high authorities of the police, did actually identify as being likely suspects. There are some that are outside of those lists that could be conceivably be the Ripper. There are a few that I think, how on earth did this person become suggested as a suspect? And they come from all over the world. I mean, there are a number that we identified as being American. There's a couple of Australian, possibly the people from Scotland and other parts of the UK. Russia as well has been identified as people from Germany. So it's one of those things that, you know, there is as many theories out there as there are people living in the East End at the time, quite literally. But I am firmly of the opinion, and we will get into this in our next show, that there is, you can navigate through all of this and identify as almost certainly who the Ripper was. And that's what we'll get into next time, I think.
I cannot wait to explore with this a little bit further with you. But I would have to say that there was no chance of this being any kind of replicant or robot.
No, there's not much chance of that. Or that the Ripper disappeared off into a parallel universe, like Karen Rickety elsewhere.
That's right. Well, you know, if Star Trek taught me anything, it is the possibility of that happening.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, we've come full circle, my friend, and I'm looking forward to picking this up again on our very next show of the Transatlantic ParaRadio show.
Absolutely, and I can assure the listeners it won't have to be 4 weeks before the next one, because we've decided we're going to bring this into our fortnightly show probably quicker, certainly with this topic, because it's such a huge topic and there's so much we want to talk about, that we're not going to leave it for a whole 4 weeks before you get the next blast from us guys. So hopefully it'll be towards the end of January, get part two, we really start to delve into those who could have been Jack the Ripper.
Good evening, Agent 47. It has come to our attention, through the highest intelligence sources, that Irene Allen Block has published her novel, The Psychic Spy. Our sources tell us that The Psychic Spy is a riveting thriller about Eileen Evans, a beautiful young psychic who is recruited by British intelligence during the Cold War to participate in their top-secret remote viewing spy program. Eileen soon finds herself plunged deeper into the darkest heart of the intelligence community as she is ultimately trained as a spy and a psychic assassin. Nick Redfern says The Psychic Spy is filled with adventure, intrigue, and shadowy characters. And as Irene Allen Block shows, the mind is a mysterious and dangerous tool. Your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to immediately purchase a copy of The Psychic Spy by Irene Allen Block, available on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and Glenatai.com. This tape will self-destruct in 1 second.
Deep in the heart of the XYZ Files, mulled wine and sulky are hard at work on trying to prove predictions are coming true.
Now for God's sake, pick another card, Eric Borer.
I am not Eric. I am Mulled Wine. Don't let me lose my concentration.
Well, kill that goddamn awful music.
Look, it puts me in the right frame of mind to predict the future with my special psychic spirit cards.
And what predictions for 2017 do you have?
Well, James, I predict that the multi-billionaire Donald Trump will be president by January 2017.
Oh, good God.
And also, I predict, please, thank you. Thank you, Pam. The Z-Files will return for next year.
Oh, please, draw another card.
Wait. I've got something.
What? Come on, what do you see?
I'm seeing what looks like, curiously, some kind of peep show. Yes, something peeping. A peeping randigit.
That was this year and the charges were dropped.
No, I'm feeling it very strongly. Paranormal. Parachute? No, it's not parachute.
Paratrooper?
It's paranormal. A peep show about the paranormal. A paranormal peep show.
Sir, you are not normal.
No, paranormal peep show, definitely. Thank you, Pam. Coming January 2017 with Andy Chaplin and Neil Geddes Ward. I don't know who they are. I can see it on the cards.
Join Andy and Neil as they take a peek into the paranormal stories of past and present, starting January 2017 on the Paranormal UK Radio Network.